God, have mercy on me. I am a sinner. In those few words, Jesus responded and said that the two people who went to pray, he was the one whom his prayer was heard. In the first reading today, taken from the book of Sirach, we heard that God will never let the prayer of the widow and the orphans go in vain. He will hear them, and he will give them what they ask of him, because their dependency is on him. We heard today in the gospel how Jesus reminds us of not how much we say, but what we say, and what kind of disposition our heart is when we say it, because God does not want to hear how wonderful you are. God wants to know how much you really make yourself understand that he is a God of mercy and compassion, and that's what he is. That's why we come to him. We come to him purposely to say to him that we need his forgiveness. I like to focus today on the second reading of St. Paul. Remember, St. Paul is pouring out his heart. And in this letter, at the conclusion of this letter, St. Paul is trying to say to Timothy, a co-worker in the vine of the evangelization, he is trying to say to him that in order to achieve the glory of the resurrection, we have to go through the cross. And there he is encouraging him and try to lift him up so that he understands in the course of his time preaching Jesus when the trouble is going to come and he is going to face the cross, he's going to understand that this is a must in order to proclaim the truth. And St. Paul begins the conclusion of his letter by saying, I am poured like a libation. I have been offered like a sacrifice. Remember that the sacrifice will not be complete unless the sacrifice is consumed. And you know what, you have liquid and you spread it. The liquid is not going to be anymore. Liquid is going to be now wasted. And that's why he said, I am poured like a sacrifice. And St. Paul continues to say, not only I am a sacrifice, but I have fought the fight. And that is very encouraging for each one of us, because to live our Christian life is not fun and games. We are fighting against the power of evil. We want to do good, and there is something within us that really motivates us to do what is not good. St. Paul said, I want to do good. I found myself doing that is not good. So that's why he said, I fought the fight. And each one of us is doing so, because we want to please God, but there is a current in our life that constantly comes to take us away from this relationship. And believe me or not, each one of us have those things. Each one of us are in those situations that we have to make a selection. Whom we are going to go with? Are we going to go with that Jesus that on Sunday we pray and praise and thank? Or are we going to go with the current of the world? I have kept the faith, and that's very important, dear people, because it's not fight the fight, but you have to keep what is more important in your life, and that is the faith that you have in God. The faith that God gave you, the faith that you yourself has accepted on your free will. When you come to the fountain of baptism, when the priest or deacon tell your parents, what do you ask of this child? And your parent or you as an adult said on your behalf, I want baptism. I want that the child will be given the faith. That faith that is begin in the life of the church, move on to the life of the parents, and is going to be, by them, instrument for that child to grow in the faith. And that faith is not something that you go and buy from the pharmacy, it's something that we have it because of people surrounding us. Remember, it's not just Holy Scripture, but also the tradition of the church that we have composed what faith is all about. And then after St. Paul was poured like a libation, he fought the good fight, he had kept the faith, he now is saying to Timothy and saying to each one of us, and I expect that the Lord will give me the crown of everlasting life. Not only to me, But to me, so those, all those like me have kept the faith, have kept to the end, have kept the Lord in our heart. And then St. Paul tells Timothy something very important. And he said to him, away from the parousia, away from the coming of Christ, because he will come. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. And that's why he said, when I was in front of the courts, in my defense, nobody was with me. And believe me when I tell you, the worst thing you can do is to promote Jesus. Because you are not going to have no support from your husband, from your wife, from your mother, from your father, from your priest, from your community. You are alone. And that's not something I say to you. Jesus said to us, they will throw you into court, they will throw you in front of synagogue, and you have to speak on behalf of me, but don't be afraid, because I will put words in your mouth. Not you speak, but I speak to you. When you promote Jesus, you are going to have enemies. And they say that it's very, very, very serious. How many of you as parents fought your children because they don't go to church? How many of you, because of your friends, you say, to try to make something for them to begin a journey with the Lord, and they refuse you, or they turn on you, or they ask you where to go? Because Jesus said, and he said it very well, unless you take the cross and follow in my footsteps, you are not my disciple. And what is the cross that we face? The cross of the world. The world wants us to go this way, and God said, no, this way. That is the cross. I want to do it this way, and he comes and say this way. And that is what we endure in this life. St. Paul knows what he is saying. When he is saying, nobody stand by me. And I hope that God will not hold me in contempt for this. But then he said something, and I wish that you will remember it in your mind. But I did what I did with the grace of God. I did what I did because he was with me. And that's why he can say, it's not me who lived, but Christ lived in me. As in formally, his speech is not speaking something from there, he's speaking from the heart. He said, I know what I did, it's not my accomplishment. I did because the Lord stood by me. And he gave me the support that I need in time when everyone was against me. When they throw me in prison. When they throw me out of their town. When they beat me many times with rods. When they put me on ships and they're about to drown. When I was in prison alone, when everyone wants to do justice to me, even kill me in front of the counselor at the bench when they are trying to make a judgment over me. But I did what I did, not with me, but the grace of God. The grace of God was enough for me, because he had. And now he said to Timothy, and you too, young man, that you are beginning this journey of the apostolate, that you are going to be the one who preached Jesus, don't get discouraged. Don't get upset because people are going to turn against you. There are going to be part of your community who will turn against you. There are some of your priests who will turn against you. There are some people who, in your community, as well at the place of work, wherever you are, they will turn against you. Don't be afraid. Because they cannot make victory. Because the victory was won by Jesus, and you are going to be suffering. But St. Paul said to him, I ask you to put your eyes on Jesus. That's your goal. Remember, in the race, all the athletes are running, and they are running to the finish line. And you need to make all effort to finish first in order to have the crown that they give you that 2 days later will fade away. But the crown that we are waiting is the crown of everlasting life. And so St. Paul said, put your hands up. And don't worry what people say. Don't worry what they are going to put fingers at you. Look at him, because there is your parousia. There is where Christ is going to come. And when he comes, he will give each one of us what we have accomplished on the face of the earth. You can say to me, well, Father, I do this, I do this. I don't want to hear it. At the end of the journey, you and I, we have to conquer ourselves. You do yours, and I do mine. And you know what? There. It's not going to be no lawyers. There is not going to be mothers to defend me, not my son. There is going to be no one but alone to defend your own. And dear people, that's what St. Paul is trying to say to the young Timothy and say to us today. Now many times, you know, when we speak about prayer, sometimes we think that the more we say, the more we are going to be heard. It's not how much words you say. Look at the young, at the sinner, the tax collector, considered by the Jewish people a great sinner. Look what he said, 6 words. God, have mercy on me, I sinned. That's all. And God knows who we are before even we ask him. And God is ready to pour his mercy on us. Just come to him. Many times, you know, you hear people say, well, you know, after all, you know, God is merciful and he can understand. Of course he understands, because I am working so hard to bring home food for my children and shelter for her health. I know God understands, you know, because my wife is not anymore the wife I married. And so God understands. Who made you God to change the commandments? Sunday Mass is his day. He gave you 6 and he left one for himself. When you come to the altar and you commit yourself to that wife is your promise for all eternity till you pass away. Who gave you the right? Because, you know, this woman is not, you know, whatever you want to have and whatever. You have another lifestyle. Who is doing what here? Look at the opening prayer today. Lord, may I keep your commands so that we can have the promise of eternal life. If you love me, keep my commands. And what St. Paul said, and for those who love God, nor eye ever saw, nor ear ever heard, and never entered the heart of man what he prepared for you, but those who love him. And to love is not I love your baby, you write on the card, so that your wife will not make angry at you if you remember her birthday, or her anniversary of marriage. But some of you ask, when do you get married? Oh, let me think it over. Why? Because love is not something that we do artificially. Love comes from the heart. And the more you love, the more you give of yourself. And that's why today Jesus is really emphasized on the way of prayer. Because that way of prayer is going to be the way we are with others. If we give God number one, we are going to give others number one. They are going to be first before us. In other words, you will go to do more for them than you do for yourself. And you know it from your very life. The more you love that wife, that husband, you will kill for that wife. You will kill for that husband. Why? Because love is something that we don't speak in. The more you love, the more you want to love. The more you receive, the more you want to give. And that is the truth you love. I don't love you because you are sexy. I don't love you because you have money. I don't love you because, you know, my God, what a gorgeous man he is. Because those days are going to fade away. Look at the pictures of your wedding and look at today. Oh. That's a different story. You love because you come from the heart. And that is the relationship we have with God. The relation with God has to be on that love, that he loves us. In fact, scriptures say, there is no love greater than this, that one lays their lives for the one he loves. And that relationship opened a great opportunity for us to really have open dialogue with God. In a few days, I mean today, tomorrow, and Tuesday, we are going to have 40-hour devotion. Many of you say, what is this? Something that you invented last night? The 40-hour devotion is to make up for the 40 hours that Jesus was abandoned in the grave. The 40 hours is also a replica of the 40 years the chosen people spent in the desert. And when we speak about desert, it's not where the camel lives. Desert is the world. without God. That's better. That's why there is no light and sin and new life of thirst. And we are asking, as a community of St. Rita, to spend time with Jesus. Now, if you tell me that you don't have nothing to thank God for, I said, you are very ungrateful. We are speaking about our continent, the continent of America. I speak about the north, not the south. How many people in our country have more than enough? Food in refrigerators, clothes in the closets, roof on our heads, jobs, health. And you tell me you have nothing to thank God for? And then it's prayer. To thank God for all that He provides for you. And then there is other things in your life that you need healing. Maybe you and your husband are not getting along because something happened. Chemistry is not meeting. Maybe he thinks this way, I think this way. Sometimes, you know, you say things and then those words remain in the heart, and sometimes it's very hard to forget. And there is the time that you spend with Jesus asking for healing. Lord, make me forget with your heart that even when they crucify you, you said to the Father, forgive them, for they know what they are doing. We need to forgive, dear people. And in order to forgive, you need to go to those rooms called the confessional. That's what our Holy Father is speaking. If we want to renew our church, there is two avenues. Scripture and confession. In order a young man will recover from alcohol, number one, he has to come to his senses and say, I have a problem, I am sick. In fact, when they go to AA, they do what they say, I am Carmel, I am alcoholic. And from there they begin the journey of healing. If you are going to be naive or you are going to be stubborn not to agree that you have a problem, and you fight everyone who told you have a problem, you're not going to recover. The same thing with our faith. In order that we grow in love with God, we need to come to the conclusion, I am a sinner. And if you are a sinner, you need to go to the truth. You need to meet with God. You need to let go of those things in your life. And that's why every month, like this Monday, you are going to have a priest here at 6:30 getting confessions. You cannot have a relationship if you don't let go of what was said or was done to each other. Otherwise, you are going to bring it up and bring it up and bring it and go nowhere. You need to come to the conclusion and say, I need to stop. And when you begin that relationship, when you come to that point, then healing begins. How many of us need that healing? Maybe there is a problem in your family or in the in-laws that is really bothering you, because sometimes you feel and you think, because that is what it is. Sometimes if you ask, what is the problem? Oh, you know what, when I get married, she said, you have been married 35 years and you remember what you said? I don't remember what I ate last night, more and more what you said. And some of them don't even have words. Oh, I don't like her. And that's it. Because you don't like her, you have all this pandemonium in the family. You are saying one thing, she's saying another thing, and you bring so much of evil here. So you need to come here. And say, Lord, heal me. Lord, give me the grace to become a better person. Lord, help me. And then the healing begins. I consider the 40 hours the time of grace for a parish. When God showers us with so many blessings, I say to you, this is a secret, but I want to share it with you. As a priest, many times, the attitude of people push me 100 miles away. But when these times come, 40 hours and the mission, not even before the end of the 40 hours and the mission, I will have emails, letters, phone calls for people to change. And I'm not dealing with you. times, I say to myself, this is not my department, we need professional help, and send them to somebody that I know that they can help. Or many times they need confession. They begin arguing about what this. I said, this is stopped. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy, how long have you been from confession? I did not come for confession. How long have you been for confession? And there I will help him with the commandments. And after he finished, he said, or she said, oh my God, I feel like $1 million. Jesus was the greatest psychologist. Do you go to people to talk when you have a serious problem? And you pay $8 or $9 a while? He wants you to come and talk to him. Ask and you shall receive. No, it will be given to you. And I will take the burden away from your shoulders and put it on my shoulders. I will believe you. Do we believe that? Do we believe that he is present in the real presence of the earth? Ah, if we really believe we are people, we have a different attitude towards faith. I encourage you, dear people, to do the best you can this week. To come to the services, take one of those green calendars, everything is set for you there, and come to Jesus. Especially Tuesday when we have the procession, if the weather permits, we go around the pyramid of the church, if not, we do it in church. And thank God for all the blessings. And open your heart. Open your heart to him, and he who knows you well, when he sees the bottom of your prayer, his mercy, his healing, he will give you 3,000 more than you have. Just trust him. Just God give God his chance. I congratulate you on these 3 days because many of you are really help us and be here with us. And I hope and pray that those blessings that I spoke about will be yours and your families in these coming days. Come to Jesus and help. Lord, I ask you to heal my husband. I ask you to touch my son. I ask you to heal me to be a better person. Because that relationship that we have together is going to reflect on the relationship I have with others. We hear people say, John put it so well. If you don't see God in your brother and sister that you see and you hear, you cannot tell me that you believe God. The God that you don't see and you don't believe. And I conclude with the words of St. Paul today, which are very powerful, and I hope that you put them here. Each one of you have come to man to be a libation, to put your prayer on that pattern. Each one of you are fighting the good fight. Each one of you wants to keep the faith. Each one of you are going to find yourself alone. And so with St. Paul we say, and I did what I did because of you. Was with me to deliver me from the mouth of the night. God bless you.